Beacon Press Audio presents Loving, Interracial Intimacy in America and the Threat to White Supremacy by Sheryll Cashin. This audiobook is narrated by Trei Taylor, published by Beacon Press Audio, 2017. Author's Notes. As a daughter of civil rights activists and a descendant of slaves and slaveholders, I wrote this book from a personal perspective. Because my life experience and voice shape this and all my work, I feel obligated to disclose the source of my admiration for agitators who cross lines. It begins with amazing parents who lived their personal creeds, sometimes at great cost. Joan and John Cashin were among the happy warriors who planned and participated in the sit-in movement in Huntsville, Alabama, in 1962. Tired of waiting for equality, they and other Huntsvillians organized, marched, and demanded to be served. One element of their strategy was to recruit white allies from the local Unitarian Church. The Unitarians, too, would march for black freedom. My parents and some of these long-haired people became dear friends. This biracial group of activists laughed a lot and called themselves the Drex Set. They were irreverent and playful in undermining white supremacy. They infiltrated white citizens' council meetings. They desegregated the Grand Ole Opry in Nashville through a ruse in which a white couple played maid and chauffeur to my resplendent parents as they stepped out of an antique Rolls Royce. Another white couple purchased a house with my parents' money and deeded it to them, enabling Cashins to integrate a neighborhood and a public school with a program for hearing-impaired children, a program that my brother needed. My parents were proud graduates of Fisk, a venerable, historically black university. They celebrated the genius of black folk and devoted their lives to helping those who had less than they did. They also opened their home to a steady stream of people of all races and ethnicities. The common thread among our guests was that they had stimulating things to say and were passionate about social justice. In 1962, as part of their strategy for bringing national attention and allies to Huntsville's sit-in movement, my mother sat down at a lunch counter with me, a 4-month-old infant in her arms. She was arrested and taken to jail, along with another black doctor's wife who was 8 months pregnant. This was the turning point in their movement. A city concerned with its image and future in the space industry soon relented and desegregated its public accommodations a year before the children of Birmingham ignited the conscience of the nation. Then my parents turned to politics. My father grew up hearing about his grandfather's exploits as a member of the Alabama legislature during Reconstruction. Herschel V. Cashin, the son of a white slave owner and a mixed-race woman of African descent, was a radical Republican and my father's hero. Dad had a lifelong dream of reigniting the spirit of Reconstruction in Alabama, of finishing Grandpa Herschel's work. Dad was a dentist by profession, but an agitator by disposition. He founded a political party, the National Democratic Party of Alabama, or NDPA, to give poor black sharecroppers, newly enfranchised by the Voting Rights Act, an alternative to the party of George Wallace. NDPA was born in 1967, the same year that Loving versus Virginia was decided. Both were assaults on white supremacy. The traditional Alabama Democratic Party reluctantly had given up its official slogan, White Supremacy for the Right, the year before. Through NDPA, blacks elected themselves to local office throughout the Black Belt where the plantation economy had once reigned. And they returned a black man to the Alabama legislature for the first time since Reconstruction. NDPA was also backed by a biracial group of riotously humorous change agents. I inherited their sense of humor, irreverence, and impatience with supremacy. I also learned from my parents that good people come in all colors, and that with allies and activism, any situation can be made better. Introduction. To love beyond boundaries is the most radical of acts. It also requires optimism. Richard Loving must have followed the light of his surname. In news clips, he didn't smile much, perhaps because his teeth were irregular. He didn't look the part of an ardent integrator. His buzz cut, rugged face, and tobacco-scarred southern accent marked him as a white working rural man of simple means and taste. Like many southerners, Loving knew people of color, but his relations with them were more intimate than most whites were willing to countenance. His father worked on a farm for a prosperous man of color, and his parents' home was down in the community where all the Indians lived, according to a resident. Loving and friends would gather at a favorite bend in the road or at the back of a general store. They had turned into a juke joint. Someone would bring a guitar or a fiddle, and this motley crew would play music and hang out together. They were black, white, racially ambiguous, high, yellow, or Indian, depending on the perspective of who was observing and who was claiming labels. Their crossing of color lines irritated the county sheriff, who literally was the race police and tried to break up their fun. Loving was perhaps the most culturally dexterous among this group. He could blend in with anybody, people said. He was playful and lived the life he wanted, loved the red-brown girl he wanted, drag race cars with his high yellow friends. In the 1950s in Central Point, Virginia, a hamlet with a penchant for race mixing, he and others willfully defied the old Jim Crow. Mildred Jeter Loving accorded with Central Casting. In a documentary about the couple and the Supreme Court case that she and her husband brought 50 years ago, she played herself better than any actress could. She was dignified, slender, and pretty, with a quiet voice that made people lean in to hear her. Richard called her Bean, short for string bean. She dressed like the housewife that she was. Her short, bobbed hair was fuzzy at the roots, but ended in shiny curls that betrayed either her complicated lineage or the pressing comb. She appeared to be a Negro or colored, words then used to describe African Americans, although, as this book later describes, she identified herself as a descendant of an indigenous nation rather than slaves. In 1958, Mildred and Richard were arrested and jailed for the felony crime of marrying. Virginia was among 16 states in that era, still sufficiently obsessed with the purity of its white citizens' bloodlines to ban whites from marrying non-whites, with varying definitions for who could claim whiteness. From 1661 until the Supreme Court ruled against such measures in the Loving case, 41 states had enacted statutes that penalized interracial marriages. Every state with such laws discouraged or prohibited whites from marrying blacks, but many statutes also named other groups that could not intermarry with whites: Chinese, Japanese, Filipinos, American Indians, Native Hawaiians, and South Asians, among others. There were legal bans, and there were social ones. Marrying, loving, and having sex across lines of phenotype were not considered normal or acceptable among most people in pre-civil rights America. In 1958, only 4% of Americans approved of marriages between blacks and whites. On June 12, 1967, the Supreme Court sided with the Lovings. The Civil Rights Revolution had roiled from a Woolworth lunch counter in Greensboro, North Carolina, to 1,000 similar nonviolent protests in over 100 southern cities, resulting in over 20,000 arrests. When Police Commissioner Bull Connor turned water hoses and attack dogs on child protesters in Birmingham, Alabama, people of goodwill supported the protesters, as did moderate Republicans in Congress, who added their votes to overcome the staunch opposition of segregation forever Southern Democrats. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 barred discrimination in education and employment and allowed people of color to dine, shop, and travel where they wanted. The Voting Rights Act of 1965 began to desegregate politics. In Loving v. Virginia, the Supreme Court added to the movement's momentum. Chief Justice Earl Warren, writing for his unanimous brethren, plainly stated that Virginia's ban on interracial marriage was designed to maintain white supremacy, an objective no longer permitted by the Constitution. It was the first time the court used those potent words to name what the Civil War and the resulting 14th Amendment should have defeated. Twice, Warren mentioned the doctrine of white supremacy, animating these laws, implicitly acknowledging that the case was not only about intermarriage, but also the ideology itself. This idea, created and propagated by patriarchs, had required separation in all forms of social relations. The ideology told whites in particular that they could not marry, sleep with, live near, play checkers with, much less ally politically with a black person. It built a wall that supremacists believed was necessary to elevate whiteness above all else. A dominant whiteness constructed by law was embedded in people's habits. Perhaps Warren thought being transparent about his pervasive racial dogma would help cure the nation of its mental illness. The onset of the long, hot summer of 1967 may also have hastened the court's desire to help dismantle the architecture of division. A race riot had erupted in the Roxbury neighborhood of Boston on June 2nd and raged for 3 days. The day before the court announced its Loving opinion, Tampa, Florida had ignited. By the end of the year, 159 race riots had roiled the United States, most lethally in Detroit, where a police raid on an after-hours bar set off a revolt that ended 5 days later with 43 deaths and 2,000 injuries. There was an impasse in race relations. As Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. delicately phrased it, a wide gap in perception between blacks and most whites about the aims of the civil rights movement and the riots. Black people were outraged by the inequality they suffered. They wanted opportunity and freedom from police harassment, squalor, and isolation. According to Dr. King, whites wanted improvement for the Negro, but not necessarily economic equality. When black folks moved beyond sitting down to order a hamburger to trying to integrate the neighborhoods, workplaces, and schools that whites dominated, a firm, even violent resistance ensued. Black people trapped in high poverty ghettos expressed rage at their limited possibilities, and white people considered riots evidence that the blacks were unconstructive and undeserving. This was the impasse Dr. King described. Alas, solely in terms of Negro and white. In 1967, the many-hued people of the United States were more focused on the Vietnam War and ameliorating or fleeing the aftermath of the riots than on the Lovings' victory for quiet acts of interracial love.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.